Welcome to the Green Ring, and thanks for watching. This video series builds on nearly two centuries of Wagner criticism and is the second of six, setting the stage for a note-by-note dissection of Wagner's Der Ring des Nibelungen in its entirety. It's a massive journey, but one I hope you'll take, never mind one I'm striving to finish. For an explanation of who I am and more on the background of this series, please check the preface video. Its link is listed in the description below. This second installment gives an overview of the direction ring analysis has taken since Wagner's day and why its current emphasis makes this video series a new voice in this old debate. Late on August 17th, 1876, or perhaps early the next day, the final notes of Goethe Dameron evaporated into the torpid summer air of Bayreuth, Germany. The portals of Richard Wagner's fresh-built Festspielhaus swirled with conversation as the first-ever public audience for Der Ring des Nibelungen left the theater. It was an impressive crowd, European and international royalty, the wealthy and powerful from around the world, a Brazilian emperor, composers, artists, philosophers, Grieg, Tchaikovsky, Liszt, Saint-Saëns, Bruckner, even Leo Tolstoy. Nietzsche's bad health, never mind his growing disenchantment with Wagner, stopped him at the rehearsals. Picking their way down half-finished gravel pathways, everyone agreed the experience had been earth-shaking, but if none dared say it, one question lingered on their minds. What did it all mean? Less than a decade later, in 1883, Wagner was dead and no longer available for comment. He left a huge body of prose and correspondence, none of it on this one burning issue. In the next decades, many stepped up to interpret what their idol had wrought. His widow, Cosima, struggled to continue the festivals. From 1882 to 1889, Bayreuth alumnus Angelo Neumann toured the ring throughout Europe. Wagner's son-in-law, Houston Stuart Chamberlain, was first in line with a book. Anton Seidel brought the ring to New York City. And in 1896, the Meister's widow Cosima revived it at Bayreuth. Despite this tireless industry, Wagner's epic remained as poorly understood as it was admired. No one could solve what was arguably the greatest artistic riddle of the 19th century. That is, except for one bright young Englishman. George Bernard Shaw was not then, nor never would be, a Wagnerite. Part-time music critic for the London Times, amateur political theorist, full-time playwright, Shaw didn't worship the composer, nor was an expert on Teutonic mythology, nor a musicologist, nor a motif hunter. But he could look past the hysterical cloud surrounding a good tale to recognize its depth and breadth. Shaw's was the first mind on a par with Wagner's to systematically grapple the ring's narrative mechanics. Before him, ring commentary amounted to bald synopses and misty theorizing. There were a host of vague praises for the noble work's high purpose that never quite pinpointed what that was. The perfect Wagnerite Shaw's Quicksilver 1898 essay leapt into this fray and set the mode of ring analysis prevalent to this very hour. But there's a problem. Shaw reasons the ring's first three chapters are a flawless socio-political allegory. He then dismisses its finale as a sellout, an operatic superficiality. In short, he brands the ring a failure. Wagner's epic attracted the young playwright's radical Fabianism as a tonic to all he abhorred in 19th century culture. Wotan and the gods symbolize wealthy bosses, giants and dwarves their oppressed workers. Wotan's self-destructive quest for Alberich's cursed ring an echo of daily headlines. Siegfried, the spirit of protest, destined to erase all that finality. Shaw relies heavily on Wagner's brief participation in Dresden's 1849 uprising, at around the time he laid down the Ring's narrative spine, insurgency hot in his blood. Shaw reasons Wagner finished his work in 1872 having lost faith in the social change imagined 25 years before. He no longer believed in heroic solutions. Unable to jibe his finale with its first three allegorical chapters, Wagner instead tied up its loose ends with a banal love panacea.
What Wagner makes much of, I have made much of, and I have explained why he made much of it.
In Götterdämmerung, one thing Wagner makes much of is love gone wrong between Wotan's grandson Siegfried and the god's daughter Brunhilde. Her encomium to the dead hero ends the drama with the very love nostrum Shaw so reviles. True to his word, he makes much of it.
Brunhild claims a prolonged scene, extremely moving and imposing, but yielding nothing to resolute intellectual criticism except a very powerful and elevated exploitation of theatrical pathos.
Shaw objected hotly to Götterdämmerung as a whole. Its Norn scene, Valtraut's narrative, Siegfried's melodramatic death, its oaths and counter-oaths, its Verdian choruses and concerted numbers, all of it vapid doggerel. His sharpest barbs he reserves for Brunhilde's evolution from wise woman to harridan, then back again in time for the final curtain. Shaw insists the scorned Virag who plots her lover's murder bears no relation to
Valkyr's
shining virgin destined to bring forth a better world. Wagner plays a confidence trick, dangling the promise of enlightenment, only to paper over its glaring inconsistencies with stale homilies. Shaw's plays hold the stage today largely thanks to his vivacious look at sexual politics, but his hard-edged realism diverged sharply from the Ring's heated eroticism, and the famed love duet ending Siegfried earns one of his most acid ripostes.
Leuchtende Liebe, lächelnder Tod, has been romantically translated into love that illumines, laughing at death, whereas it really identifies enlightening love and laughing death as involving each other so closely as to be virtually one and the same.
This antipathy for Germanic sentiment goads him to a factual error. Passionate, i.e. sexual love,
did not play a very large part in Wagner's own laborious life.
Anyone familiar with current Wagnerian scholarship can only smile. But in 1898, Shaw had little to go on. Wagner's shamelessly expurgated memoir, Mein Leben, wouldn't appear for a decade. While Chamberlain and Glasenapp didn't publish their heavily censored biographies until a few years after The Perfect Wagnerite. The Wagner-Cosima von Bülow triangle might have been infamous in Shaw's day, but a good Englishman, he looked the other way. In any case, his main objection was that sex had demolished his socio-political allegory. Wagnerians of Shaw's day rationalized eroticism in the Ring as more exalted than it seemed, thus more dignified than it was. Shaw traded this romantic humbug for social dogma, his lasting gift to Ring analysis. But it comes at a price.
Though I have shown that Wotan is godhead and kingship, and Loki, logic and imagination without living will, brain without heart, put it vulgarly, yet in the drama, Wotan is a religiously moral man, and Loki a witty, ingenious, imaginative, and cynical one.
Such interpretive sleight of hand didn't worry Shaw any more than it has his analytic descendants. Like him, they treat the drama's characters, events, and concepts as symbols. But philosophical abstractions make for poor theater. Freud and Jung pioneered allegorical symbolism. Shaw opened those floodgates to symbolist Ring interpretation. That doctrine was set in stone by the 20th century's first decade. Ernest Newman, Shaw's de facto analytic heir, might not share his social views, but does take his allegorical gospel as read. Thanks to it, directors and designers across Europe responded eagerly to Adolf Appia's theories on symbolist theater. Meyerhold, Wildermann, Fehling, Hirth, Klemperer, and more helped establish a robust symbolist tradition. After Wagner's widow Cosima died in 1930, even conservative Bayreuth put aside strict realism for a period of experimentation led by Heinz Tienchen and Emil Praetorius. Then National Socialism threw its nightmare cope over Wagner. His detractors delighted, his advocates floundered. Wagnerism seemed dead, but it was only getting its second wind. After World War II, the composer's grandson, Wieland, took over Bayreuth. He enlisted Shavian allegory with a vengeance in dazzling shows that perfected the symbolism pioneered by Appia. Performers wandered hypnotically across empty stages adorned by little more than light and dark. Audiences made what they could of the drama's complex musical dramatic web. Shaw had come home to roost. At Bayreuth and around the world, Ring Productions chose allegory with extreme, even outrageous abandon. In the 1970s, Melschinger, Herz, Friedrich, Kupfer, and others traded Wieland's spare Appian vision for lush visual complexity, yet kept faith with its symbolist imperative. Chereau's notorious Bayreuth Centennial Ring used television to lock Shavian allegory into mass consciousness. Hydroelectric dams, steel forges, cast iron dragons, and Victorian waistcoats took symbolism to its logical extreme. In the wake of this post-war boom, a new surge of interest swept print analysis, still true to Shavian doctrine. Conservatives like Bailey, Cook, McGee, and Tanner tacitly agreed with their more adventurous colleagues, Donington, Levin, White, and Nattier. The Ring was neither drama nor myth, but philosophy steeped in symbolism. Opinion on the work's underlying message ranged from social constructs to Jungian psychology to anti-Semitism to Wagner's personal theories of art history. The underlying premise was still the same. Gods weren't gods, giants not giants, dwarves not dwarves. All stood in for this or that allegorical construct. Even Cook fell prey to the allegorical mania. The central reality the drama is concerned with, obviously, is the social and political history of mankind. The problem remains what it was in the late 19th century when Shaw claimed to make much of what Wagner made much of, then didn't. No matter the thrust of this or that allegorical interpretation, it must ignore, minimize, reinterpret, or explain away what doesn't fit its own approach, the working definition of confirmation bias. Shaw decrees Wotan is symbolic of Godhead, then presents as meaningful only those instances of the immortal's behavior which reinforce his hypothesis, treating all the drama's characters and events in that way. One late 20th century analyst blames this on the work itself. It does encourage reductionist interpretations. Wagner's use of mythology as raw material for his music dramas tempts one to somehow equate the figures, objects, and events portrayed within the Ring with extraneous systems of thought. To the goal of establishing a consistent interpretation, the critic often has the tendency to explain away details and inconsistencies. This has its drawbacks. Beyond hints at some kind of allegory, glimpses into a larger meaning behind the story, one cannot successfully assemble these pieces into an allegorical level of meaning that will encompass the entire work of art. The parallel always seems to eventually break down. Somehow, something just does not fit right. In Shaw's case, this includes the end of Siegfried and all of Goethe Dämmerung. For Sikora, the entire work collapses. Newman agrees.
Wagner sometimes lapses into a prolixity that is saddening or maddening, according to the frame of mind we happen to be in at the moment. Most of his prolixity is to be accounted for by bad text construction. The unfortunate part is that he does not merely voice the mere crude notions of his own organism, but that these notions step outside the circle of art into those of philosophy and politics, and therefore provoke criticism from other than artistic sides. A novel that is a tract is bad enough. A poem that is a tract is infinitely worse. But what shall be said of a music drama that is a tract? Put more succinctly, decades later, vigorous dramatic coherence was difficult for Wagner under the best of circumstances. It was thoroughly impossible in this bulky work so long in creation. Abate takes this to its logical extreme, calling The Ring the ultimate conflict of words and music. And Sikora feels Wotan's Valkyrie Act II monologue deconstructs the entire tetralogy. The Ring shows that a modern myth that has political intent will inevitably come apart, and in self-reflexively demonstrating its own nihilistic political aesthetic program, destroy itself. Wotan's existence is really mortal, as much as he would like to deny this mortality and defy the end. Real gods are immortal. He is not an almighty god presiding over a genuine mythological cosmos. Almost in revenge, it seems, he therefore destroys it. A look at the source mythology exposes cracks in this argument. The gods of Teutonic myth are every bit as mortal and or immortal as Wagner's counterparts. A mistletoe dart kills Baldur, Odin's beloved son. And gods both mythic and Wagnerian must eat magic food in order to survive, while both ultimately perish in fiery conflagration. This is the central weakness of allegory. Mythological objects in the tetralogy that have metaphorical significance are in this way demythologized, dematerialized. They don't work as real objects, but only as metaphors. Thus the Ring at times dematerializes its own mythological content. When myth is reduced to a state of mind within an apparently mythological drama, the work of art falls apart and is destroyed from the inside. This or that analyst may style as only metaphorically significant mythological objects and posit they reduce myth to a state of mind. That's their lookout, not Wagner's. Allegories reflect not the epic itself, but a commentator's opinion. Such approaches have interest, but they deconstruct themselves, not the Ring. The real test of an analysis is how much of Wagner it dismisses to achieve coherence. The Green Ring takes the work in its entirety at its every word, its every note. This brings us back to the Ring's central mystery. What does it all mean? August Rückel, Wagner's compatriot imprisoned after the 1849 Dresden uprising, was first to puzzle the key to that riddle when he asked why, if Brunhilde redeems them, must the gods die? After more than a century, there's still no agreement. It bothers P.J. Ride to the point he suggests a minor change in Rheingold. Erda's odd prophecy there is a continual snag, whose vagueness about why the gods must perish leaves Berger wondering, why doesn't the forest bird tell Siegfried to return the ring to the Rhine maidens? Then everyone can live happily or miserably ever after. Wagner clarifies all, but only if taken at his word. He wrote Franz Liszt, it is strange, but only in the course of composing the music does the essential meaning of my poem dawn on me. Secrets are continually being revealed to me which have previously been hidden from me. To preserve its agenda, allegory must ignore this crucial revelation, bypassing the musical syntax which revealed so much to its own creator, and may yet do the same for us all. From the beginning, commentary despaired of Wagner's groundbreaking musical technique.
Volzogen might have been the first to identify a limited number of its elements, but grasped those as no more than signature tunes. Shaw took him at his word and passed over the music, calling it emotionally striking, but narratively extraneous. Newman then sharpened the argument with his own detailed complaints.
Wagner frequently makes a double error, that of expecting from the leading motive more than it can possibly perform, and that of employing it where it is quite unnecessary. The mere fact that there can be any doubt in the matter is fatal to Wagner's theory, since the very object of the system of leading motives was to make the past and present and future of the drama intelligible to a degree that was impossible by any other means. If there is any room for doubt as to the meaning of a musical reminiscence, it might as well have been omitted from the score.
Theodore Adorno echoed him with open contempt.
From the outset, the necessity for commentaries revealed the bankruptcy of Wagner's own aesthetics of immediate unity.
The degeneration of the leitmotif is implicit in this. Allegorical rigidity has infected the motif like a disease. Such warning shots moved Lawrence, Dethridge, Tanner, Darcy, McCreelis, and many others to explore every aspect of the ring but its minefield of thematic syntax, a blistering hot potato to this day. With palpable distaste, Millington notes,
"A veritable industry devoted to explaining the ring and its motifs."
Respectable analysts cite only a handful of prominent morphemes and leave it at that. Music, after all, has no meaning in the concrete sense Wagner intends. But there's no excising the Meister's musical syntax from his epic. The question must be settled. To date, the only two options are despairing of its flaws or brushing it aside. Recent entrants in the Wagnerian Derby, Sabor, Holman, and others, tactfully limit their remarks to a few carefully chosen words about the most familiar syntax. Gutmann sums up the still-prevalent attitude.
One must not overemphasize this leitmotif aspect of the Wagnerian drama, which has been credited too long with a descriptive explicitness its creator longed for in theory, but which the musician in him happily precluded from complete realization.
Cook's introduction to Der Ring des Nibelungen stood little chance in this environment, whom Dollhaus must have had in mind when he advised rebuttal rather than further exploration. Cook sails uncharted waters. He organizes the Meister's ideas into what he calls families. As with human genealogies, these trace offspring sired by various primary morphemes, children resembling parents and more distant relations, yet with distinctive natures of their own. Relationship chains develop meaning throughout the work's modular structure, into a many-channeled skeleton of oral cues. This gives the Ring's music that uniquely comprehensible narrative power which enlightened Wagner even as he composed it. Traditional analysts are at best lukewarm about Cook. I Saw the World End is occasionally mentioned, while his breakthrough musical studies are mostly ignored.
Cook's interpretation of Wagner's musical architecture occasionally seems forced. It is highly systematic.
The analytic preference is Opera and Drama, Wagner's 1851 essay on musical drama. Its theories don't match its composing practice, but that gives the allegorical school more license to favor his poetic text over its music. What's been totally ignored is Wagner's lifelong obsession with the direct causal link between music and meaning. In 1851, while constructing the Ring poem, he wrote his friend Theodor Uhlig,
"I realize that the themes that I write always originate in the context of and according to the character of some visual phenomenon on stage."
Wagner had much experience in opera staging, where he learned the potent subconscious impact stage action has on audiences when precisely fit to music.
A booklet he sent to opera houses performing his Fliegende Hollander describes the Dutchman's first appearance in microscopic detail.
I have discussed this scene at so much length in order to show what weight I place on the most careful adapting of the action to the music.
He was still more specific with Christian Stocks, whose early Tannhäuser staging essentially made Wagner's fame.
My orchestral accompaniment never expresses anything for the ear to hear which is not also intended to be expressed on stage for the eye to see, be it by means of actions on stage, gestures, or simply by facial expressions. If these are either omitted or fail to coincide exactly with the appropriate passage in the orchestra, an understanding of my intentions is rendered impossible.
Wagner commissioned Heinrich Porges to observe rehearsals for the 1876 Ring premiere, then write a diary for future generations. Its staging comments focus on visual action matched precisely to music, what opera and drama calls gesture, both in singers and stage effects. This is what generates the evolutionary growth of meaning Wagner envisioned. His morphemes aren't abstract symbols, but sonic gestures, designed to elicit physical action. They transform music's intangible sounds into an audible language that evolves with the poem it supports. It's an immovable obstacle to interpretive license that moves Adorno to sniff.
It leads directly to cinema music, where the sole function of the leitmotif is to announce heroes or situations so as to help the audience to orient itself more easily.
Yet, it's an audience's single most potent tool for grasping Wagner's massively complex work, one deeply sewn into its living fabric, far more than inert signposts hooting the same message whenever they sound. It's a vibrantly evolving web, pregnant with as-yet-undiscovered meaning. In one sense, there's justice in disparaging motif hunters. Wagner's method leaps far beyond so limited an approach. In The Language of Music, Cook suggests musical phrases may be arranged into progressively meaningful groups, just as words assemble into language. It's the genius of Wagner's method, who links his associative modules into the music equivalent of words, sentences, and paragraphs. Together with his verbal text, they drive the epic's narrative in ways inaccessible to either separately. The next video examines this associative process in depth. As always, thanks for watching. Please feel free to leave comments. Lastly, as all YouTubers know, please subscribe to this channel and hit the bell to be notified of the next video.